I want you to take your Bible. Some of you are about to leave. Don't leave. Please don't leave. I want you to take your Bibles. I want you to go with me to the book of Galatians. And today we're in Galatians chapter 5. And of all the chapters that we've looked at so far, chapter 5 is my favorite chapter here in the book of Galatians. We started this series just a few weeks ago, and in chapter 1, we talked about how that we have been freed by grace. Chapter 2, freed through faith. Chapter 3, freed in Christ. Chapter 4, we're free to grow. We talked about that last week, that Christ would be formed in us. And then today, we're going to talk about being free to run. I can tell we got folks that don't like to run. I didn't get too many amens. Too many amens on that. Today we're going to talk about being free to run. And our whole title of this series has been Set Free, Live Free. You know, now that we've been set free by the grace and the love of Christ, we need to live in that freedom, to walk in that freedom. And Paul even says we need to learn to run in that freedom. Now, Paul evidently was a really big sports fan, because if you read his letters, a lot of times he compares the Christian life to some kind of an athletic imagery. You know, he talks about the Christian life being a fight, and he talks about boxers, you know, going at it. And then he also talks about, and this is probably the image that he uses more than any, he refers to the Christian life as a run, as a race that we are in. You remember even at the end of his life, he said, I fought a good fight. I finished my race. I finished my course. And then he said that I kept the faith. And so Paul many times uses the image of a runner and a race to help us to understand a little bit about the Christian life. Now, here's something that's really, really important. Paul never used the imagery of a fight, nor did he ever use the imagery of a race talking about our salvation, okay? Because he doesn't want us to think that we're saved by any human effort whatsoever. Because how many of you know that we are not saved as a result of what we've done or what we do? We're saved as a result of what Christ has done. And then all we have to do is put our faith and our trust in Christ. Paul said it best in Ephesians 2, 8 and 9 when he says, for by grace are you saved through grace, not of yourselves. It is the gift of God. Listen, not of works, so that no one can boast. Listen, when we get to heaven, aren't you thankful that people aren't going to be walking around in heaven saying, hey, let me tell you what I did to get here. No, when we get to heaven, we're not going to be boasting about ourselves and what we've done. When we get to heaven, all we will be boasting about is what Jesus did to get us to heaven. And that we were smart enough to put our faith and trust in what Jesus did at the cross for our salvation. So getting to heaven is not a result of anything we do. It's totally all what Christ has done and us putting our faith and trust in him and following him from this point on in our lives. But listen to what Paul says here in Galatians chapter 5, verse 7. He says, you were running the race so well. And remember, he's talking to a church of Gentiles, of Galatians here. There were some Jewish people there in the church. But he's talking to these Galatians who experienced salvation by grace through faith alone in Christ Jesus. But now that they have experienced salvation, they're now beginning to try to live the Christian life in and of themselves. You know, it's like they've abandoned grace, and now they're like, okay, well, from this point on, you know, everything I do is up to me. It's all human effort to get me from here to the end of my journey. And Paul says, you were running the race so well. You started so well. You know, you were in the lane of grace. But he said you didn't stay in your lane. How many of you know we can get in trouble when we don't stay in our lane? But look at your neighbor there and tell him, stay in your lane. Yeah, stay in your lane. He said, you were in the lane of grace, but then he said, here's what happened. He said, then somebody cut in front of you, and you ended up switching lanes. And instead of staying in the lane of grace, you began to listen to false teaching about the gospel, and you got out of the lane of grace, and now you're in the lane of human effort. You've been cut off, and you're following now the wrong leader. You're following now the wrong gospel. He said, you need to get back in your lane. Get back into the lane of grace, because the same grace that saved you is the same grace that keeps you, and the same grace that enables you to live the Christian life. And so he says, you were running the race so well, but who's held you back from following the truth? See, there were folks that were coming in and saying, no, yeah, you need to be saved by grace through faith in Christ, but it's more than that. It's by faith through grace in Christ plus religion, plus rules and rites and regulations like circumcision. And so they start believing and following the wrong people, the wrong group. Have you ever been late somewhere? Like, none of us have ever been late. I mean, come on, folks. I have faith every Sunday. When I walk in here and start a service and there's 50 people in the house at service time, and I just have faith, they'll be here, they'll get here, just hold on, they're coming. And looky here you are, praise the Lord, give yourself a hand, amen. But how many of you know what it's like to, you know, you're trying to get somewhere and you're in your lane, and then all of a sudden somebody cuts you off. And you think that they're in a hurry, that they cut you off, so they're going to get on down the road, but they cut you off and then poke. Don't you hate that? When somebody gets in front of you and slows you down from your destination. That's what Paul is saying. He said, man, these folks have cut in front of you. They've become a hindrance to you. And then he goes on to verse 8, and listen to what he says. He says, it certainly wasn't God who did that, because God is the one who called you to freedom. Man, isn't that awesome? That God has called every single one of us, not to a life of bondage to the law, not to a life of bondage to religion, not to a life of bondage and slavery to sin, but God has called us to a life of freedom. And church, can I tell you this morning, that is my heart for you. I want you to live free, depending on, living every day of your life, depending upon the grace of God. Now, as Paul begins here in Galatians chapter 5, the first thing that he does is he talks to us about two enemies of Christian freedom. So listen, those of us who are Christians who desire to be free, we need to understand that there are enemies of Christian freedom. And he said the first of those enemies of Christian freedom is this. It's called legalism. Yeah, we've talked about legalism. This is us thinking that we can earn the favor of God by our human effort, by our works, by our good deeds. That's what legalism is. And he says this in Galatians chapter 5, verse 1. He said, so Christ has truly set us free. Amen. So he says, now make sure that you stay that way. Make sure that you live that way. Make sure that you don't get tied up again in slavery to the law. You've been called, you've been set free from your bondage to the law, from your bondage to religion, from your bondage to sin. So he says, whatever you do, don't get tied up with that again. Don't get out of the lane of grace and start running in a lane of bondage. Don't get tied up again in slavery to the law. And then he says this in verse 2. He says, listen, I, Paul, tell you this, that if you are counting on circumcision or works of any kind, religion of any kind, he said, if you're counting on circumcision to make you right with God, that is to justify you before God, to put you in right standing before God, he said, then Christ will be of no benefit to you. So here's what he's saying. He's saying that if you think that your works, that your human effort is enough to gain the favor of God, Then he said, everything that Christ did for you on the cross, everything that Christ did to set you free is of no benefit to you. It's almost as if Christ never did it. So he said that if you're counting on circumcision or human effort or works or religion to make you right with God, then everything that Christ did is of no benefit to you. And then he goes on to verse 3, and he says this. He said, I'll say it again. If you're trying to find favor with God by being circumcised, then you must obey every regulation in the whole law of Moses. So he said, not only do you lose the benefits of Christ, but you gain the burden of the law. Oh my goodness. Because here's what he's saying. He said that if you think that you can gain favor, if you think that you can experience salvation through your own human effort, through your own works, through your own deeds, he said, then here's what that means. That means that you're going to have to keep, if you're trying to gain favor with God by keeping the law, then you're going to have to keep all of the law. Not just some of the law. You can't pick and choose, you know, which laws you want to live according to. No, because to break the law in one area is to break the law entirely. How many of you know that there's only been one person who ever walked the face of this earth who could keep the law perfectly, and that was Jesus? Jesus did what we could not do. Jesus lived a perfect, sinless life. And then he went to the cross, and he took upon himself your sins and my sins. And in doing that, he redeemed you and I from the curse of the law, because the penalty of our sin is death. And so what did Jesus do? Not only did he do what we couldn't do in living a perfect life, but he did what we couldn't do in dying for the sins of the world. He gave himself at the cross. He gave himself at Calvary, and in doing that, he redeemed you and I from the curse of the law. Amen. So that now, instead of death, we can receive the gift of eternal life. Come on, somebody. That's a good trade any day of the week. And then he goes on in verse 4, and listen to what he says. It gets better as we go through this chapter. He said, because if you're trying to make yourselves right with God by keeping the law, you've been cut off from Christ. You're trying to do it yourself, apart from Christ. And he said, if that be the case, then you have fallen away from God's grace. Now, a lot of people have asked, what does it mean to fall from grace? Well, Paul here is not necessarily saying you lose your salvation. Because as you continue to read through the book of Galatians, he still refers to those Galatians as brothers and sisters in Christ. But what he is saying to them is this. He is saying that you have lost your grip on grace. That you've stopped trying to live by grace. And you're now trying to live the Christian life in and of yourself. And he said, so because of that, you have fallen away from the grace of God. And instead of depending on God's help, you're trying to do it all by yourself. And so he would say to us this morning, whatever you do, hang on to grace. Don't let go of grace, because none of us can get where we need to go without the grace of Almighty God. 'Tis grace that brought me safe thus far, and grace will lead me on. And let me tell you something, there's something that we'll still be singing about, and there's something that we'll still be talking about even 10,000 years after we've been in the presence of the Lord. When we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we've no less day to sing God's praise than when he first begun. And what's that song? Amazing Grace. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Hallelujah. I was blind, but now I can see. Oh, aren't you thankful for the grace of God? And then listen to what he says in verse 9. He said, this false teaching, he said, it's like a little yeast that spreads through the whole batch of dough. That's why he says, we can't let this thing fester. Once you recognize false teaching, you got to deal with it right then. You can't let it continue, because it'll spread through the whole body of Christ. That's the way it is with sin, Paul talked about. that sin is like yeast. And if we don't deal with it immediately, it's going to destroy our entire lives. This is good stuff that Paul's trying to help us with today. And then he goes on to verse 10, and here's what he said. He said, I'm trusting the Lord to keep you from believing false teachings. I could say that this morning about Cooper City Family. I'm believing God to keep you from believing false teaching. But one of the ways that God does that is he speaks truth through his messenger. And listen, we're going to find out who really loves me today and who don't love me. Right? Because Paul said this. Paul said, as long as I was telling you what you wanted to hear, you were my buddy, you were my friend. But the minute I began to preach truth to you, I suddenly became your enemy. I pray when we leave here today that I'm still your friend. And I'm still your pastor, because I am going to tell you some truth today. But look at what he says now in verse 11. He goes on and he says, dear brothers and sisters, he said, if I were still preaching that you must be circumcised, as some say that I do. See, Paul himself was being accused by some that he was preaching a gospel that included works or circumcision. And of course he was not doing that. He said, if that were the case, he said, if I were preaching the same message, then why would they still be persecuting me? He said, there's a reason why they're persecuting me. And he said, and if I were no longer preaching salvation through the cross of Christ, no one would be offended. Because what was offensive to them, to those false teachers, what was offensive to them was that salvation is by grace alone, through faith alone, in the accomplished work of Christ alone at the cross. And to those Gentiles and to the Jews, the cross was foolishness to them. But to those who believe, he said, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. And he said, if I were to stop preaching the message of the cross, nobody would be offended. But how many of you know that Paul wasn't going to stop preaching the message of the cross? Let me tell you something. The message of the cross may not be preached in a lot of churches, but the message of the cross will always be preached at Cooper City. Amen? We're not ashamed of the cross of Jesus. No, we're not ashamed. We're not ashamed to have a cross on our building. We're not ashamed to have a cross hanging in our building. No, because we know that if it had not been for the cross, come on, somebody, that's where you and I were justified. And then he goes on to verse 12, and listen to what he says. He said, I just wish that those troublemakers, man, I love this, because I feel Paul here. We sense his humanness here now. And he said, I just wish that those troublemakers who want to mutilate you by circumcision would mutilate themselves. And he's not saying that those who have not been circumcised will be circumcised. He said, I'm just praying that those who are preaching that circumcision is a part of salvation. He said, I just pray that the knife would slip. And they would completely castrate themselves so that their false teaching cannot continue to be reproduced through them. That's pretty serious stuff. Man, when you start praying that on folks, come on, gentlemen in the room this morning. Don't make me have to go there. Don't make me have to pray that prayer. Legalism is an enemy of Christian freedom. Let me tell you something else that's just as much an enemy of Christian freedom, and it's the complete opposite of legalism. It's called license. Because here's what some people will say. They'll say, well, you know, now that I'm a believer, and it was all by grace, all by what Christ Jesus did, not a result of anything that I did, then evidently my Christian life is the same. And since I don't earn favor with God by my human effort and by my works, then that means I can just do whatever I want and I'm going to be okay. No. That is not what the Word of God is saying. Listen, in Galatians chapter 5, verse 13, listen to what Paul said. He said, for you've been called to freedom, my brothers and sisters, but he said, whatever you do, don't use your freedom to satisfy your sinful nature. Don't for one minute think that now that you are free in Christ, that you are free to do whatever you want to do. Because that's exactly what some folks will say. Now I'm free to do whatever I want to do. You know, I'm under God's grace. I'm going to make it to heaven regardless. And Paul is saying this. Paul is saying, whatever you do, don't use that freedom to satisfy your sinful nature. I mean, just that statement of saying, well, you know, now I can live any way I want to live, and I can do whatever I want to do. I mean, listen to that. That statement itself screams of bondage. That you are still in bondage to yourself and to selfishness. And you're still in bondage to sin. You are still a slave to sin when you say, I can live any way that I want to live. Listen, no, you are not free from Christ. You are free to Christ. You are not free to do whatever you want to do, but you are now free to Christ to do whatever it is that He wants you to do. Because you see, the moment that you and I accept Christ Jesus as our Lord and Savior, at that moment, the Spirit of God takes up residence on the inside of us. The Spirit of Christ lives on the inside of us. Now, do you think that the Spirit of Christ living on the inside of us is going to tell us to do something that's contrary to what Christ Himself has commanded us to do? Absolutely not. Absolutely not. The Holy Spirit, the Spirit of Christ that lives on the inside of us, is there to lead us and to guide us and to help us do what Christ has commanded us to do. Does that make sense? All right? Okay, so two enemies of Christian freedom is legalism and license. But then he gives us three essentials of Christian freedom. Three things that you and I need to know as we run this race called the Christian life. And he would say this first of all. He said, whatever you do, remember to run by the Spirit. And notice, Spirit is capitalized. I'm talking here not about your Spirit. I'm talking about the Holy Spirit on the inside of us, enabling us to live a Christian life. Because notice what he says in verse 5. He said, but we who live by the Spirit. That's followers of Christ. That's how you and I are supposed to live now. We are supposed to live by the Spirit, not the flesh. We are supposed to live by the Spirit, not human effort. We are supposed to live trusting and depending on the power and the enabling of the Holy Spirit, not trusting in our own human power and enabling. Let me tell you what the Spirit of God living on the inside of us enables us to do. First of all, here's what Paul said. He said that the Spirit of the Lord enables us to fulfill the law of love. Now, just in case some of you think, well, you know, I'm no longer obligated to the law of Moses. You're right about that. But there's a new law. There's a new covenant. Right? And that new covenant was made for us when Christ went to the cross. He fulfilled the old and he ushered in the new. You remember one time that an attorney came to Jesus, a young lawyer came to Jesus. And he said, Jesus, what is the greatest of all of the commandments? Now listen, if you go back and count, they've been able to identify about 613 Old Testament laws. Now, can you imagine trying to keep all of those? And out of those 613, there were others that just kind of sprouted off from them. We also have in the book of Exodus, God gives us what we know as the Ten Commandments. But an attorney comes to Jesus one day and he says, Lord, what is the greatest? Out of all the commandments that you've given us, what's the greatest? And here's what Jesus said. He said, I'm going to take those 613, even the 10, and he said, we're going to narrow it down to 2. This is what he was talking about when he said, all of you that are burdened by the law, he said, come to me and I'm going to give you rest. Because he takes 613 laws and narrows them down to 2. And he says, if you'll just do these 2 things right here, then you will fulfill all the law that was given by the prophets and by the writers of the Old Testament. And he said, here's those 2 laws. Number 1, love God with all of your heart, mind, soul, and strength. He said, that's the first and the greatest commandment. And then he said, the second one is like it. He said, love your neighbor as yourself. And he said, if you'll just do those 2 things, you'll fulfill all the law. Well, that lightens the load a little bit, doesn't it? I mean, even when you look at the Ten Commandments, the first four commandments of the Ten Commandments deal with our relationship with God. Don't take his name in vain. Don't put any other gods before him. Don't worship idols. And then the last six commandments of the Ten Commandments has to do with our relationships with other people. Don't commit adultery. Don't murder. Don't steal. Don't covet. And Jesus said, listen, the solution to that is this. Just love God with all of your heart, mind, soul, and strength, because if you do, you'll not put another God above him. Just love God with all of your heart, mind, soul, and strength, and you'll not take his name in vain. He said, love your neighbor as yourself, and when you do, you won't steal from your neighbor, and you won't covet what your neighbor has, and you won't commit adultery. You see what he's trying to say here, folks? And the Spirit of God, because even those two, we can't even do those two without the help of the Holy Spirit, somebody. Come on. Listen to what he says in verse 13. He says, for you have been called to live in freedom, my brothers and sisters. But don't use your freedom to satisfy your sinful nature. Instead, he said, use your freedom to do what? To serve one another in love. But we can't do that without the help of the Holy Spirit. It does not come natural to us to serve. It comes natural for us to be served. And Jesus himself even said, I did not come to be served. I have come to serve. And so now that we have the Spirit of Christ living on the inside of us, don't you know that the Spirit of Christ is going to say the same thing to us? That it's not about us. It's not about us being served, but it's about us being like Christ, because the Spirit of Christ works in us to help us be like Christ and to do what Christ wants us to do. And so therefore we will love the way that Christ loved. Come on, somebody. The Holy Spirit wants to set somebody free here this morning, and he gives us the ability, he gives us the motivation to serve one another in love. And then he goes on in verse 14 and he said, for the whole law can be summed up in this one command, just love your neighbor as yourself. How many of you know we don't got no problem, pardon the English, loving ourselves? We love some of us, don't we? And he said, just love your neighbor as yourself. But we can't even do that without the help of the Holy Spirit. Listen to what he says in verse 15. He said, this is why we need this. He said, if you're always biting and devouring one another, watch out. Beware of destroying one another. No. Come on, folks. Let's serve one another in love. With the help of the Holy Spirit, let's love our neighbor as ourselves. And then here's another thing that the Spirit of God enables us to do. The Spirit of God enables us, get this now, to overcome the flesh. Whew, it's about to get hot in here. Just going to tell you now. Can I tell you something that the Holy Spirit will give you the power to do that up until that time you really didn't have the power to do? The Holy Spirit will give you the power to say no. Can I say that again? How many of you know that there is a word no in our vocabulary? He gives you the power. He gives me the power to say no to my fleshly desires and to my fleshly wants. No, notice what he says as he goes to verse 16. He says this. He said, so I say, let the Holy Spirit guide your lives. The Spirit of Christ, let it guide your lives. Then, that is, when you let the Holy Spirit take control, then you won't be doing what your sinful nature craves. How many of you know that hungry, thirsty, craving, sinful nature will be with us till Jesus comes back? But notice what he says. He says the way that you can say no to the cravings of your flesh is by being guided and being led, doing what it is that the Holy Spirit wants you to do. And then he goes on in verse 17, and he talks about this Man, the struggle that's going on with every one of us, even those of us up here on this stage. He said that the sinful nature wants you to do evil. Come on, somebody, say amen right there. Don't act like you're perfect on me this morning, like you don't know what I'm talking about. The sinful nature wants you to do evil, which is just the opposite of what the Spirit wants. And the Spirit gives us desires that are the opposite of what the sinful nature desires. And then he said, these two forces are constantly, somebody say constantly, all the time, never stops. These two forces are constantly fighting each other so that you are not free to carry out your good intentions. How many of you know that in every single one of our lives here this morning, we are in a battle between our flesh and the Spirit? And you say, well, who's going to win? Whichever one you feed the most is the one that's going to be the strongest. If you're always giving your flesh what your flesh wants, then your flesh will grow, and your flesh will rule, and your flesh will dominate. But if you feed the Spirit, hallelujah, if you do what the Spirit of God wants, then the Spirit of God gets control, and the Spirit of God has the power, come on, to help you overcome and me overcome our fleshly desires. Hey, can I remind you this morning, those of you that would say, I've tried and I've tried and I've tried, I just don't have any power, I don't have any ability, even as a Christian, to overcome the cravings of my sinful nature. Listen to me. Paul said this in Ephesians. He said, the same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead lives on the inside of us. Come on, somebody. That's power. If it can raise Jesus from the dead, how many of you know it can give me power to say no to the cravings of my flesh? Come on. Thank God for the Holy Spirit. And then he goes on in verse 18. He said, but when you are directed by the Spirit, you're no longer under obligation of the law of Moses, but you are under the obligations to do what Christ commanded you to do. And then in verse 19, he says this. He said, but when you follow, this is where trouble comes. It's when we follow the desire of our sinful nature. When we say yes to the cravings and the thirsts and the hunger of our flesh. He said, here's what it leads to. He says, the results are very clear. Sexual immorality, impurity. It's getting quiet in here. Anybody notice? Anybody besides me notice how quiet it's getting? Sexual immorality, impurity, lustful pleasures. Go on to verse 20. He said, idolatry. Other things become more important than God. Sorcery, hostility, quarreling, jealousy, outbursts of anger, selfish ambition, dissension, division. He goes on, he says, envy, drunkenness, wild parties. Some of you were in one of those last night, and you're here this morning. I'm glad you're here. Praise the Lord. He said, let me tell you again, as I have before, that anyone living that sort of life will not inherit the kingdom of God. Now listen, he's not saying that he doesn't realize that from time to time we might slip and sin, because none of us are perfect. But he's talking about those who continue in their sin, who habitually sin. Because if we continue in our sin, even after we say that we've come to Christ, if we continue in our sin, habitually sinning, we need to go back to the cross. Because listen to what verse 24 says. He says, those who belong to Jesus Christ, what have they done? They have nailed their passions, and they have nailed their desires of their sinful nature to the cross, and they have crucified them there. Let me tell you, when Christ died on the cross, I died with Christ. Paul said it like this, I have been crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ, the Spirit of Christ, lives through me. Hallelujah. Come on, somebody thank God for the Spirit of Christ, for the Holy Spirit that indwells us and enables us to fulfill the law of love, to overcome the flesh. And then here's the last thing. He enables us to produce spiritual fruit. Oh, only the Holy Spirit can do this. You cannot manufacture love. You cannot manufacture peace. You cannot manufacture joy. Only the Holy Spirit can produce love and joy and peace. And listen to what he said in verses 22 and 23. We saw what following the cravings of our flesh produce. But he said, but when you follow the Holy Spirit, he produces this kind of fruit in our lives. Love, joy, peace, patience. Oh, come on, somebody that needs some patience in the room today. Kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. And he said, when you bear these kind of fruit, when this kind of fruit has been developed and produced on the inside of you by the Holy Spirit, you don't need any laws. Hallelujah. And then he says in verse 25, he says, so since we're living by the Spirit, let us follow not the cravings of our flesh, but as children of God, let's follow the Spirit's leading. Listen, he will lead you. You know, we may not have the law of God written on stone as they did in the Old Testament, but the law of Christ has been written in our hearts. And the Spirit of Christ leads and guides us according to that. That's why when you're faced with the decision of should I do this or should I not, that's why you have the Holy Spirit saying no, no. Don't do it. Don't go there. Don't watch that. Don't watch that. Don't do it. He's there to lead you, to guide you into truth, into blessing. So he says, follow the Spirit's leading in every part of your lives. Can I just say something right here before I just hit these last couple of things? Can I say something about the fruit of the Spirit? Listen, the fruit of the Spirit is not produced to just be looked at. You know, where we just say, man, what? Those are some red, shiny apples. Look at those mangoes. They all look ripe and juicy, man, don't you know? No, no, fruit was not produced to just look at. Fruit is produced to be eaten, to be enjoyed. And can I tell you that this world is starving for love? They are starving for joy. They are starving for peace. They are starving for kindness. God, help us to be to them what they need, to be Jesus to them. So we run in the Spirit. Secondly, and listen, I'm almost done. Just give me a couple of more minutes. Secondly, and let me tell you what we're about to do. We sung about a new name written in glory. We're about to baptize about 11 folks that's going public with their faith this morning. I'm so excited about it. But here's the second thing. We run in hope. In hope. Listen to what he says again in verse 5. He says, not only do we live by the Spirit, but he said, we eagerly wait. That's hope. We eagerly wait to receive by faith the righteousness that God has promised to us. Do you know what we're hoping for as children of God? You know, right now, in Christ right now, positionally, we are perfect before God because Christ is perfect. But practically, we're messed up. Practically, we still mess up. Practically, in our everyday lives, we still sometimes slip and sin. But here's what Paul is saying. He said, we're eagerly awaiting that day. Hallelujah. And really what Paul is saying is, I can't wait until judgment day. I can't wait until Jesus comes back. Because he's saying this. He said that one day, and he said, I believe this. I have hope that one day when Jesus comes back, he said it like this in Philippians 1 and 6, that he who began a good work is going to continue that work until it is finally finished at the day of Christ. And Paul is saying this struggle between my spirit and flesh, it's not going to go on forever. One day Jesus is going to come back and I'm going to receive the full manifestation of his righteousness. I'm going to be just like him because I'm going to see him as he is. Oh, hallelujah. That's what I look forward to. the day that this battle between my spirit and my flesh is over. Woo, come on, somebody. And then lastly, we run by faith. Listen to what he said. Not just by the spirit, hope, but by faith. Because he says in verse 5, look at it. He said, but we who live by the spirit eagerly wait to receive by faith. We wait for the full manifestation of the righteousness of Christ to be revealed in us when Christ returns. But notice, we're not eagerly waiting and trying to earn it by human effort and works. How do we receive it? By faith. By faith. That's why we can look forward to Judgment Day and stand before the Lord and know that in that moment, the fullness of his righteousness will be revealed in us. And then he said this in verse 6. He said, for when we place our faith in Christ Jesus, there is no benefit in being circumcised or being uncircumcised. He said, what is important is this: faith expressing itself in love. Do you remember what the half-brother of Jesus said about this? James said this. He said that faith without works is dead. So for those of us who think you come to Christ, you didn't do anything, it was all what Christ did for you to experience salvation. For those that think that now you come to Christ, now you don't do anything, that's not what he's saying. He's saying you're just not doing it to try to earn the favor of God and to try to earn your salvation. No, faith expresses itself. Faith expresses itself in love. And I thank God this morning, as these folks that are going to be baptized, as they come and get ready this morning to get baptized, I'm thankful this morning for a church that just doesn't talk about faith, but they express their faith through love. Amen. See, that's why we make sure that if people are hungry, they get food to eat. If people don't have clothes to wear, we make sure that they have clothes to wear, shoes on their feet. If kids are going back to school and they lack school supplies, we make sure that they have the school supplies that they need. If teachers going back to school don't have what they need, we come alongside and we help them. Single moms and dads and the challenge that they have as single parents, husbands and wives today that are raising children, and they have their children come to them struggling with their sexual identity and anxiety and suicidal thoughts. Let me tell you what a church who has faith expressing itself in love does. It comes alongside those families and it supports them. And it says, listen, we are here to serve you. We are here to support you. We are here to help you any way that we possibly can. Why? Because our faith is not dead. Our faith expresses itself with the love of Jesus. Come on, somebody. Can we stand to our feet this morning and thank God for his grace? Thank God for the power of his Holy Spirit that has changed and transformed us from the inside out. With every head bowed, every eye closed, if there's anybody in this room right now that would say, Pastor, today I want to give my life to Jesus. Today I want to surrender to his lordship. Today I put my faith and my trust. I'm gonna stop trusting in my good works, my good deeds, my human effort to get me to heaven. And I'm gonna start trusting in what Jesus. Today, I'm gonna put my trust in what Jesus has already done for me so that I can be set free. Is there anybody in this room this morning that would say, today I want to receive Jesus as my Lord and Savior? Let me see your hand. I'm looking the best way I can. God bless you, sir. Bless you, sir. Can I get one of our prayer partners to come and pray with this gentleman right here this morning? Sir, that's the best decision that you could ever make. And I'm proud of you. Hallelujah. I'm proud of you, sir, because you don't care who's looking at you. You don't care who's watching. Today, you've made a public decision to follow Jesus Christ. Is there anybody else in this room here today that would say, I see hands going up in the back here. Can I get some prayer partners to go back there and pray with those that have their hands up, that need somebody to help them pray to receive Jesus this morning? Isn't this awesome, folks? Isn't this awesome? Let me tell you something. Jesus publicly hung on a cross. He was not ashamed of his love for us. And I'm not ashamed to publicly declare this morning that he's my Lord, that he's my Savior, that he's my Redeemer, that he's my Deliverer. Hallelujah. Come on. Come on. Let's give God praise. Come on, let's go back into that song. There's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine. Let's celebrate those that have made decisions to follow Jesus this morning. Let's rejoice with heaven this morning, because heaven rejoices every time somebody comes into the kingdom of God. Come on, let's thank God for it.